Today's Don't Waste Warrior partner is Jabo Superfoods. We want to take the time to thank them for the offer that we provided during this episode and for teaming up with the podcast to provide a better listening experience for you. You can find out more about Jabo Superfoods at www.jabosuperfoods.com or by visiting stillmazewarrior.com. What's up, Still Maze Warriors? Here I am again with another episode. And before we get started, I want to mention the partner for this month, which is Jabo Superfoods. You can use promo code SMW Jabo, and you get 10% off. So we got to honor that. Thank you to Jabo for hooking it up and partnering up with the podcast and making it possible for you guys. All right, so today I'm actually really excited because I have another individual that's interconnected with the Tengu system, and I had Pavel Widuto a couple of podcasts before. In case you haven't listened to that one, we had him on the podcast, and it was a great one, and he kind of introduced his system. So today we have Damien. And I had asked him to just let us know his last name because it's so hard to pronounce. So go ahead, let us know your last name.
Hello, guys. It's Yashkevich. So it's tongue breaker.
I was like, see, I got to let him. So I'm pretty sure listeners will understand that. So let's get into your story, man. Let's get to know you a little bit for people who've never heard of you before. Tell us about your journey in fitness, kind of like what led you to the maze, because you use the maze a heck of a lot in your Instagram post. And then finally, like what led you to Tengu?
All right. Yeah, no problem. So I started fitness maybe when I was 16, 17, but back then, like in Poland, it was rough time, you know? You could do fitness or you could be a nerd, you know? There was this kind of stretches, you know? And there was no knowledge, so the guys only done bodybuilding. So I was a skinny guy that wanted to put the weight. I was on a diet for some time, but it was too expensive, so I quit. And it was from like coming and going along the way. But then when I moved to Ireland, when I was 21, I started to do it regularly on the like generic gyms. And, you know, just to keep myself fit, because it was different, cultural difference between Ireland and Poland that was, everyone was doing this here, you know. Wow. We have great runners, everyone is running, you can see people running over here. It started to change in Poland, I think it's changed already, you know, but people put much more knowledge, start to, you know, look on the exercises more in intellectual way. So there's, you know, even the people that my son's friend told me, Damien, you're working out, yeah? I said, yeah, I'm a coach, you know. but you are a nerd. I said, yeah. So you're a jack-up nerd. That's pretty rare. I said, you can be nerdy about everything in your life.
Right.
However, if you like to educate yourself, if you like to dig in some topics, you can be nerdy about everything, about football, about a lot of stuff. Yeah. So yeah, that's what I started to do. I started to dig up in like human anatomy, movement, and in the end, I end up in Tengu. But in the meantime, 3 years ago, I went on a personal trainer certification and fitness instructor. But the knowledge wasn't there, you know? Mm. There's big gaps between what we see in the normal gyms and what we would like to see. It's not health-based. Mostly is movement for the sake of moving.
Right.
For the sake of moving. So people want to burn fat, because that sells and that keeps your customers busy, you know?
Right.
So, you know, like 20 half hour on the treadmill every day, it's something normal. And back then I was doing a lot of kettlebells because somewhere along the web, I came to the Onnit website.
Oh, right. Everyone ends up on the Onnit website.
Yeah. So like, yeah, Austin, Texas is like, you know, first base for the fitness education. And I looked, you know, on all their like functional training workouts. And I started to do kettlebells from Instagram, you know, which end up badly. Like I didn't get injured or something like that, but I will tell the story later. So on the certification, I was told I'm very good on the kettlebells. I said, yeah, because I'm doing that, you know? And then I start to dig into the steel mace.
Right.
It wasn't steel mace then because I did order quad mace. That was my first mace.
Wow. And that's like the heaviest one.
No. Yeah, that was a mistake. I didn't know back then, you know, like.
It's because it looked cool, right?
Yeah, it's cool, it's heavy, and you can do a lot of things with it, yeah. But when I look at my workouts back from like 2 years ago with the quad, and I said, no, I wouldn't recommend to anyone to start from this point, yeah? So when I start to post videos with the mace, my friend connect me to the power. And I was on the crossroad back then. So after the certification, I could choose which path I can go. So I did think about the CrossFit, okay? And then Pavel reached to me and said, like, listen, you know, you can do that stuff. You know, you can do mace stuff and you can do functional training properly. So probably if I would do CrossFit, if I would be a CrossFit trainer, I would have a lot of clients, I would have, you know, regular job and this kind of stuff.
Right.
But it's not the thing that, from my point of view now, it's not the thing that would keep me expanding myself, you know, right. Keep my knowledge going. So I end up with Pavel and I went to UK to Pulse gym for certification, and we had only two people on that certification.
Wow. So it was
very personal, very emotional, and it was very good. But the lads say you have to clean your kettlebell. You know, you suck, you're gonna injure your clients, you're gonna injure yourself, you know, because you're not hinging, you know. And that's because I was lifting very heavy, my lower back got locked. You know, I was able to lift, like, you know, deadlift 150 kilos, but that was all with my back muscles, not with my hips. So I didn't hinge. So I end up getting a personal trainer, you know, and that's the word Paul said, like, coaches need coaches. If you suck at something, you have to get it right, especially if you want to show it to the other people. So. Yeah, so I went to Dave Hedges in Wild Geese Fitness Training. I think I spent there maybe 2 weeks, maybe three, four sessions, and he got cleaned everything. That's the first thing. And second thing, he taught me the hard style, soft style, and style of kettlebell training. So,
wow.
Yeah, that got fixed, you know.
And that's actually a really cool topic, just to dig into that. I mean, yeah. In your opinion, let's say someone is listening to this and they're like, you know what? He's right. How do they find like a good coach? In your opinion, like what was your process to find a coach?
I was recommended, like Dave was recommended by other coaches that I already knew, you know, and they were movement coaches. They weren't, you know, bodybuilding coaches. So they knew he's doing that. And he's doing Mesa as well. And he's doing Indian clubs. He has very cool martial art gym, but Dave, the difference between Dave training, because he's very technical, he's very educated, and he trained athletes, he trained people for kettlebell sports, he trained people for jiu-jitsu, for this kind of stuff. With my type of training, and it's hard to reach people that way because first thing they go to Tengu, they look, oh, it's dark, you know, it's dark, black, yeah. Red. Is it MMA? No. For the people with sedentary lifestyle to, you know, to balance your lifestyle and to decompress the muscles that are tight. Okay, and they leave, you know, and that's it, you know, that's why I talk with Pablo. It's hard in Ireland because I had a guest maybe 3 weeks ago, and he's a mobility coach. brilliant coach. And he said, that's the first time I see something like that. That's the first time I see Steel Mess, you know? So in States, it's getting very popular. Ireland is the one of the fittest countries in Europe. You know, it's one of the five top fittest. But the problem is, like, it's all treadmills, it's all bodybuilding, it's all losing fat, you know, then it's pain, broken joints, and not lack of recovery, you know, because recovery, someone thinks recovery is going back home after workout, spending 2 days on the couch and, you know, watching the gains grow, you know, watching my muscles, I'll be big, you know. And in Tengu, we do it differently. We want people to move every day, but different way, you know.
That's awesome.
So, yeah, I ended up with Pavel this way. We connected. But we found that the connection is a little bit bigger than, you know, in the business style or even like physical style, because it's not only about training, you know. We found out, like, I was doing early medieval reenactment, so I was doing Viking reenactment. He's doing the same. At some stage, we were doing pagan celebrations, you know, for all the people, like from different backgrounds. And he's very spiritual person as well. We have different approach to it, you know, because he's more shamanic. I'm so more social oriented. So I think, you know, those celebration was more about the community building and this kind of stuff. And he's healing through this, you know, energy. So
right.
You know, different approach, but we have a lot of connections, spiritual connections and mental connections, you know. He's way older, way more experienced, and he's a, you know, guy that I look to. But yes, so like we end up in opening Tengu Island.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. And you know what? It's funny that you mentioned the spiritual side, because that's kind of what attracted me to him. Because I'm very spiritual, so I think he's definitely hitting the right people for sure. And that's what you guys want.
That's what he said. You know, people are coming to his certification for Element Cycle, not without a reason. You know, they are there for the purpose. You know, there's something bigger going around there. Not all of people will understand how Element Cycle work, and that's what I found out. You know, in AFM, we produced a lot of coaches, but not all of them change their approach. You know?
Right.
So if someone's, because everyone can do Element Cycle, everyone can do AFM, but the reason why they change, because like they like to do powerlifting, okay?
Right.
And I think that's the difference. What I was thinking lately about, if you want to be a good coach, you know, you won't be best athlete.
Mm.
You won't be best athlete. Why? Because good coach have to spend more time in different areas. He have to train everyone with their needs, when the athlete can train for his purpose.
Right.
All week along. So athlete will get injured more, you know, because he have to spend his time efficiently and he have to train in his area of work.
Got it. That's interesting.
I think if you want to be best at something, don't be a coach. You know, if you want to be a coach, be best at coaching people, talking to people, knowing them and give them what they need. Okay. But if you want to be an athlete, you'll be an athlete, you know?
Right. Yeah. That's awesome. Yeah. Now
that's what I think, you know, like.
Yeah. Yeah. That's so cool. So let's talk about like the element system. Cause you just mentioned that not a lot of people know about it. Let's talk a little bit about the elements, because we kind of touched on that in the past podcast, but just let's reiterate it a little bit. So what is the elements, the cycle system?
Like for me, the cycle system is it's a program, you know. So at the moment, I will start to run programs in Tengu Island when you can do one training a week if you want to get better in one element. But after this like 6 weeks program, you should switch the element to something different, because it's going from a higher stress level to a lower stress level or medium stress level. So we have earth and fire, which is, you know, high intensity or high stress, high load training. But then next day, like if you're doing day to day, you decompress that. So I know exactly what exercises people were doing. Okay, so if they were squatting a lot, I know, you know, which muscle was tense, which muscle have to be decompressed. So we're using workouts, water workouts for that. So we're decompressing their lower back, their glutes, their hamstrings, or whatever they worked day before. And because it's even the high stress level workouts are not that impacting the muscle group as a whole body, you know, it's easier to balance that with day. And the same air workout is, you know, mobility, but people approach air workouts and I cannot do that, you know, it's too sophisticated, it's too difficult for me. Because you cannot do mobility if you don't have prerequisitions. So if you don't have strength, you will suffer, you know, doing your air workouts, because you won't control the load. So it's all interconnected. That's why we work in the cycle. So it's high stress, low stress. And in the end, like if people could do like 4 days a week, they would get a like full package and they won't feel any pain. I had my girlfriend started to swing the mace. You know, I told her, you have to swing the mace and you have to do the kettlebell swing, because she sucks at it. She never done it. And because of her lifestyle, that's, you know, two main exercises that I want her to master before she tried to start to train regularly, you know?
Right.
So we done the mace, we done the preparation, we done the restoration after the workout. But next day, because she was suffering from injuries, spinal prolapse and sciatica before. So, and now next day she was like taking painkillers, because this hurts.
Yeah.
What I think what happened over there, it's traumatic, you know, it's mental pain. Mm. Not even her like physical pain, it's her, you know, mental state that, you know, she get like lactic acid or, you know, any strain over there, and it's, you know, it's pulsing in her head, whole body. So we done a water workout after that, you know, and I knew exactly what she need, you know, that day. So, you know, two days later, you know, she didn't feel any pain. But wow. she was so angry that she said, I will go to Tengu and I will melt everything down. And I don't know what I will do with this melted steel, but I will melt everything down, you know, every kettlebell steel, you know.
That's so awesome. It's so great to hear that.
Yeah. So
she tried it, you know.
She's going to get there. But because, you know, she's didn't do anything for a long time, it's gonna get her longer to get there, you know. Right. But yeah, we're working out with like I said, you know, I started coaching people, and the same on the like first my first certification. It scares me, you know. It, like, okay, I will be coach, okay, so I will have to take care of people, and I don't want them to be in any pain,
right?
And you know, in this, I don't know, 7 month certification, they didn't teach me how to do that. You know, my range of motion, my lower back was already broken. You know, and they didn't. Then I had to go to UK. I had to go to the Paul and Pavel certification for them to tell me what to do to get myself fixed. Because we are all broken. No matter how fit you are, there's always something that you can fix. You know.
Right. Wow. So you traveled all the way to the UK for that.
Yeah, it's not that far. It's not. It's very close. Ireland is, you know, just a small island just beside UK. So it's close enough.
Shows how passionate you are, though. That's awesome,
man.
So talking about, you know, I guess everyone's a little broken. You posted a blog post last month. I think it was last month. And you talked about the psychophysical stress.
Yes.
Yeah. And I read it and I liked what I read. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So that's the same thing. It's like if you look how we live today, you know, at our lifestyle, that we compress our chest and we hold our devices in front of us. Neck is bent, and I find myself doing that when I'm going to work or somewhere. You know, I'm like, my head is going down.
Yeah.
And if you look on the like victim pose, if someone is lying on the ground and he's been beaten up, it's the same thing. So he's compressing his chest, he's bending his neck, and like he's under stress. So that's what, why he do that, you know. He's under stress, physical stress, and that's why his body is trying to compress. So if we live day from day in the same position, you know, it affects our thinking, it affects our mind. So we are in the physical state of a victim for 8-10 hours a day. We'll be sitting at work, it's the same, we compress our chest. And that's affect our thinking, that's affect our work, that's affect our relationships and everything. So that's why training with Steel Mace is opening not only our physical body but our mental state, because what we do overhead with the overhead swings, we open our chest. Yeah. So many people, and we get our shoulders together in the back. So, right. You know, this bullhorn position, that's what in India they call it, the horn of a bull, when we do that. So we're opening that and we balance our everyday stress.
Wow, that's interesting, because I always heard it from like a whole mobility type of view, but you just added that.
Yeah.
Something, so that's actually pretty cool to know.
Yeah, it is. Like, if you look, it's all, everything is over here, it's compressed. And the guys going to the gym, to the general gym, and what they do? They compress their chest even more.
Oh, yeah, with the bench press.
They don't open that much, you know. You know, their favorite exercise is, you know, bench press.
Yeah.
You know, and working on a big chest muscle, yeah. But what's that do to their mental state, you know? They go under even deeper stress after, you know, be stressful already whole day. So we try to open the chest, you know, compress our back muscles, and then decompress. And it's, everything is working. So it's the same with the kettlebell swing. If you look at it, you know, if you sit, you know, it's the same. You want to compress your glutes and open your thighs. So that's why we swing with the. That's why I train Renata with it. You know, two basic exercises that everyone should do every day or every second day, that they should learn to keep their mental state intact. You know, that's my approach. And it's, I know it's hard, because both of those exercises are very technical, and it's hard because of our lifestyle, because we are already so compressed over here. So it's hard for us to lift something overhead, you know? That's why it needs for the people to train, you know, to be prepared, to have a prerequisitions before going to that exercise, and then start slowly putting more and more and more weight, you know? It's not like me, 12 kilometers. You know, wrist hurts, you know, elbows hurts, and the range of motion is somewhere over here, no?
Right.
So start slowly. And for me, problem was getting a mace is lighter than 4 kilos. I bought them all in Ireland. I don't know, 12 maybe. You know, no one's do that. So I bought like 12 maces, and they are already so loud. But I needed lighter. I needed lighter for women and for girls and for boys that didn't do any overhead, they didn't swing the mace, and they want to be, feel safe. And that's why where the pulver handles came, you know? Because it's plastic, because it can be 0.5 kilo, and they won't injure themselves.
Yeah, and I asked you about that on Instagram. Yeah, I sent you a message. Oh, yeah. Those things are so cool.
Yeah, they are. And you can like do, you can do a clap, you know, Indian clap or a clap bell from them. You can fill it with concrete. Then you can, you know, twice the length and you have a bulava, okay? The things that Pavel used. Then you can put three or even four over there, you know? Wow. The downside of that you won't go, I think, heavier than 4 kilos or
right.
3 kilos, you know? But for starter, it's brilliant, you know? Because you can do one hand swing, two hand swings. You can do mobility work. It will be hard for you to get heavier load with it, okay? Because you want to go heavier. Everyone should go heavier because that's learning progress, you know, learning process. If you will stay with the same weight and do the same exercises all the time, you won't progress.
Right. You know?
So you want to get those 10-2s and 360s heavier with the time. But if you're just starting, even get a stick and, you know, get a bottle, you know, fill it with water, you know, do something, and that's your starting point. It costs maybe, I don't know, $5 or $6.
Right.
But you can get to the movement already, you know?
Right. Now, what are some of your favorite mace movements?
Oh.
If you could pick, okay, let me make it easier. If you could pick like two.
Okay, 10-2, yeah, it's my favorite one. I started to train competition style, you know, so 5 minutes, as much repetition as I can. And I got some pretty good results. But because I was training with the quad mace, after 3 minutes, your hand gets sweaty and it slides from the wood, you know. So you have to get this grip even stronger. And that's a good sign, you know, that's a good sign because you have to train your grip. But it would be easier if I would get a pommel on the back, you know, still, and this kind of stuff. So 10-2, why? Because first thing is, you know, mobility, like I said, opening chest, compressing back. Second thing, it can be cardio, because you can do it for 20 minutes, I don't know, 25 minutes. One day I've done it, I think, for 40 minutes with the 4 kilo mace, you know.
Wow.
With the breaks, but yeah, you can do it like full 40 minutes workout with it. Marathon, you know, yeah. And then you can train for strength, you know, smaller repetitions, bigger loads. 10-2, and the second one with the mace, I don't know.
That's a hard one, huh?
I would tell you what's my favorite. Why? Because I cannot do it yet properly. It's an overhead squat.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, why? Because because I'm, you know, I'm restricted, so my body is going a little bit front, you know, when I squat with the mace, you know. God. That's why it's my favorite, because I can work on it, you know. It's not something, and even with 10-2, I found myself, okay, I can fix this, I can do that better, I can do that better, because people will see, like, video, okay, he's doing that, and he's doing that, fine. No, it's never going to be perfect. That's the first thing you have to learn. It's never going to be perfect, because, okay, one thing, you can activate your core more. You can do this more, better. You can pull it more from the side than from the back. You know, it's always little tweaks that you can do. And, you know, I'm training mates maybe for 3 years already, and I still find myself I can do a little better.
Yeah.
And with overhead squat, yeah, I can do it, you know, but I cannot do, I still have a long way to go with my, like, connection of my upper body and lower body.
Yeah.
Because most of the people, when they overhead squat, they will go even over here, you know, they will bend to the front. For me, the difference is not that big, but I still feel uncomfortable doing that. So that's the thing, I should work even more. And it's a complex exercise, you know, because it's connecting, you know, squat with the overhead press.
Right.
You know, with overhead press, I don't have problem with the squat. I don't have problems, but doing those together, you know, they are connected, and your whole structure is acting differently. So yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Wow.
If it's hard, you should work on it.
Yeah, that's a good one. All right. So I was scrolling through your Instagram and I noticed like a quote that you had up, and it was, "We are movement." I want to dig a little deeper into that. Like,
no, that's you will find it even more of them in the future. But generally, the story about that is I was training in SBG, yeah? And I was doing free classes over there just at the start when I started AFM. So SBG is a gym founded by a brother of Conor McGregor, you know? Oh. So I was really excited. Like, you know, top one of the brands over here. But what they do, and they do best, is martial arts. They suck at fitness. they suck at fitness, you know? So yeah. I was thinking, because they start to open their gym, and they had a very good functional place to do this over there. I think, yeah, why not, you know? So when I started, the head coach from SBG called me movement coach. And I didn't know exactly what he meant by that, you know?
Yeah.
I'm not movement coach, I'm art of functional movement coach, you know, back then, you know? So I didn't know what he means, you know? And unfortunately, you know, movement can mean everything, you know? Most people, because they knew what is functional movement, they was thinking I'm a guy like Ido Portal, you know Ido. You have to check him out.
Yeah, he's
He was training McGregor as well.
Oh, okay.
His fights, so he done all this body weight movements, animal movements, a lot of, you know, beautiful stuff, you know.
Yeah.
But he don't train with maces, he don't train with kettlebells, he just do you know, amazing strength and mobility stuff with his body, you know?
Right.
So yeah, this difference. But yeah, so like then I went somewhere else, you know, and I ended up that I'm a part of a movement community coaches, you know. And everyone's different over there, you know. We have guys that doing handstands, you know. One friend of mine is doing handstand and splits, and he's perfected that, you know, and he was training me as well, you know. I don't have time to, you know, perfect this, but I did want to learn that and train other people if they will want to do. And second thing, it's opening new gates as well, you know. So you want every week to learn something different, something new, you know?
Right.
And then I was thinking about Tengu, you know, because we are so different from the generic fitness industry. So I said, yeah, we are rebels, you know, we are rebels. I don't have any barbell at my gym, you know. I don't have treadmills. I don't have this, you know, normal stuff that you see on the gyms. So I said, yeah, we are rebels, you know. So we are movement. Because of that, we are the movement that I think will end up the era of the like 1970s bodybuilding fitness industry, you know? And on the second thing, we are movement because we are oriented about moving your body, you know, in correct way, in a beautiful way, you know? We all want to move with grace, you know? We're meant to do that. We're not meant to be stiffed and be, you know, attacked by pain from every direction, you know. We want to move with grace, and we want to do it pain-free. So that's why I said we are movement.
Wow.
And not only Tengu, you know, there's a lot of functional coaches and functional companies and gyms that do that at the moment. And our aim is to change the approach to the people, how they look about training, you know? It's not only building muscle and burning fat, building muscle and burning fat. No, it's the things that you should do every day, and you're not doing it now. But hopefully, you know, when the people get more educated, they will go, I don't know, to the park, and they will start to do this stuff with their bodies, because they will be able to, you know?
Wow, I'm glad I asked that question then, because I saw it and I knew. I was like, I have to, it like came up to my head. I'm like, I'm going to ask him about that. That was beautiful, man. That's awesome. And I'm glad that Tengu's coming around, because there is this big gap that, you know, that's going on, where I think health and wellness should be, you know, fitness, yeah, health, yeah, you know, should be one thing, and it's not really, even over here in the US, it's not. It's not.
And to be honest, it's mostly about the money at the moment, because if you will fix people and people will learn to do that, they won't need you.
Yeah.
You know, they will learn how to train, they will buy them kettlebell or mace. People think like that, you know, they will train at home or they will build their communities or something like that. But it's not like that, you know. It's not like that because I know that people will come over there because for the love of movement, you know, for the love of what they learn over there. I've seen it in the Paul's gym. You know, where people that train over there, they come in and they do their workouts itself because they are so well educated, their knowledge is so big enough that they already know what to do. And they will say, you know, in my gym, I said, okay, we have a fire day. I said, I don't feel today like I'm, you know, I would do fire, you know, I've done a lot of walking yesterday, I need to decompress, so I will do water. And they do it in his gym, you know. So, you know, they still go, they build the community, and they are so aware of their bodies, you know, that they know what they need. And wow, that's our purpose. And for me, it's the same. I was doing water one day, and I overstretched my lower back, you know, because it was locked, you know, it's very stable, it's very strong. But when I start to decompress that, you know, it can be painful sometimes. Something can open up over there that was tight, very tight.
Yeah.
So I end up with the, you know, back pain, you know, not even after working, you know, it's normal, you know, something. But you need to know what to do, you know, to balance that stress. To if you overstretch it, you know how to how your body is reacting to the pain. You need to know how to tell your body how to, you know, fix that pain, you know, how to heal it.
Wow.
So I don't end up with something with doing 40 down dogs, up dogs, 40 of them, you know, in a row.
Wow.
And I said, it's fixed. You know, it's always learning, always learning. I wouldn't say it's gonna help my back, but it apparently it did, because a lot of movement, you know, a lot of joint fluid went to my discs, you know, and you know the pain stopped in like 20 minutes.
Wow.
So yeah,
wow.
Like the same I said to my, I have a guy that's training for half marathon, mega marathon, 60 miles run, you know, he's training for that.
Wow.
And because he's very strong in the lower body, he's very weak over here, you know.
Mm.
And he had problems with his wrists. So I showed him exactly what he have to do before and after and every day to get it stronger. And he was so afraid of his, you know, weak wrists that he said, I cannot do this, I cannot do that, I cannot do this, I cannot do that.
Wow.
I said, yeah, but if you will avoid of any work with your wrists, they won't get stronger and they won't heal. And then you will need to do something with them and they will break. So, you know, it's every day you have to do a small steps, and it's always the weakest link in your body will come to that, you know. So if he's doing push-up, you know, he's strong enough to do a push-up, but his wrist, he's thinking his wrists are, you know, already so weak that he, you know, he won't do it. So we find a way, you know, we find the easiest way to get those tissue around the wrist joints stronger, and for him to do a pull-up someday, you know.
Wow.
Yeah, but because people are very good at avoiding pain, avoiding small stress. If they experienced pain before, they think, you know, avoiding the stress will fix the problem. It's what you want, you know, it's just running away.
Right, right. Mm. Tends to stiffen a little more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Right on, man. That's awesome. Wow. You gave me so much knowledge just from this podcast. I think this is one of my top favorite ones for this season.
And to be honest, I'm very young coach. You know, I'm very young.
Well,
I'm training with with Element Cycle maybe for 14 months. And back then I was maybe a I was training people maybe for 6 to 8 months. Wow. And that's, you know, that's my thing. Not even training, you know, educating yourself.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. And I love the approach, cause it's almost, you know, I've done CrossFit before and I'm not like talking bad about it, but kind of like with CrossFit, it's like they give you a wad and you do that for the day and you're not, yeah. you know, you're not considering the differences in people. And yeah. you're definitely not allowing them to listen to their body if you're like, go, 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 go. So it's really cool to hear that there's a system and that there's people like you out there that are teaching things a little differently.
Yeah, exactly. And especially like in Element Cycle, we have a different level of fit people. So we level every exercise into different levels. So we have of like every station, if we do even kettlebell rows, okay, we regress that or we progress that, you know, for the client. And intensity, intensity is very personal thing. You know, one person will do it very fast and he will be okay. Second person will do like 3 rows and his shoulder will, you know, be so weak that he will have to stop. Okay, we're doing that for 1.5 minutes. If you will do 3 reps for the 1.5 minutes, that's okay. Next time you will do 5.
Right.
Okay? It's not like you have to. People come to the gym because they want to, and they should want to, you know, give their best, okay? But not more. Don't give more than your body is limited to, you know? Because we're not there to overstress ourselves, you know? We're there to enjoy ourselves. We're there to give, you know, 100%, you know, don't do 120%, because, you know, along the way it will come back after to you, you know.
Yeah, right on. All right, well, I think that's I mean, that pretty much takes care of all the questions I had about you, other than where can people find you if they wanted to find you online, and any other information. If you have any upcoming events, go ahead and blast them right now.
And you forget one thing. ECS, Element Cycle System in Yuma.
Yes, well, I was gonna mention it afterwards, but I might as well do it now. So yeah, I'm really excited. And by the way, this was not a planned thing, in case you're listening. Like, I had not, like, I was already scheduling Damien when Pavel Widuto like came to me and he asked me if we could set up a date in Yuma. So that was a total coincidence, and it just helped because you kind of explained what Tengu was, and you did it really well. I'm sure Paul's going to like be ecstatic about that. But yeah, so we're going to have the Tengu Element Cycle System in Yuma, Arizona, on September 28th and 29th at Yuma United Mixed Martial Arts. And if you want more information, there should be a link in my bio. If you go on my Instagram, it's also on my website. And obviously on my Facebook and everywhere else. So don't miss that out if you're in the state of Arizona or anywhere around here, because you definitely, if you're a personal trainer or a coach or just into functional training, you know, this is something that you do not want to miss. Did I do that right?
Brilliant.
Right on. All right, so how do they find you?
Okay, you can find me on Instagram, tengu.island. Okay, it's the same on the Facebook page. If you're looking for the gym page, it's Tengu Island. And myself is going to be Damian Leszek Jaszkiewicz. I try to say it with the American accent, but I don't know. Okay.
And the American here can't even say it, so I apologize about that. But I'll make sure I'll add it on the blog post and I'll put it everywhere.
And the other thing, like, Pavel is coming to Yuma and Pavel is coming to Ireland as well. So if you're living in Ireland or in the UK, we have a certification on 13th and 14th of July in Tengu Island, my place. So the place isn't that big, so the places are limited. You know, let me know. We're going to search you out.
Right on. Yeah, and that's something I failed to mention too. There's a limit on our spot too, because it's a little small. So, I mean, if you guys want in, you guys better get it like soon. Get your deposit down and get all of that booked. All right. Well, thank you so much. I feel so honored to have you on here.
Yeah, I'm honored too. That's my first podcast ever.
Oh, really? All right. Yeah. Okay, cool. Well, thank you so much. And may the universe always flow with you.